Filling my heart as I sing. dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Welcome. It is good to see you, those who are part of our church family and those of you who are visiting, whether in person or online. Thank you for setting apart this morning to join with us on this very important day on the Christian calendar.
Many years ago, about this time of year, there was a man arrested, tried, and crucified. His arrest was because of betrayal. His trial was plagued with falsehoods, and his crucifixion was unjust. It would appear to have been the worst event in all of biblical history. It seemed that Satan had won the victory and succeeded in his plan to put to death the Son of God. Yet we call today Good Friday. How can any of this be a good thing? It's because God's power turned Christ's death into something good for mankind. Through the death and resurrection of his Son, God provided for our forgiveness and eternal life in heaven. On this Friday, this Good Friday, our debt was paid. That is why we set aside this day to worship God for his amazing love and his mercy towards us. Thank you for coming this morning. I trust that you will be blessed by this time in God's presence and with his people.
What love my I love those lyrics we just sang together, specifically the verse that says these words, "What love, my God, would send the way of life to walk the road, rejected and despised, that you might know the weakness I possess and be my rock of strength and righteousness." Over these last 2 months, for both our services and in our life groups, we have been working through a sermon series we have called Choosing Jesus. This series has been based around the Gospel of Luke and how Luke describes the life and ministry of Christ. Today and on Sunday, we are going to continue to listen to Luke and specifically hear how he describes the events surrounding this esteemed weekend. This weekend that changed the world forever. And here's the thing that's so amazing about this weekend. The events of it gladly changed my life some 2,000 years later. And we pray the events of these 3 days has or will change the lives of all who are hearing the description of these events both today and on Sunday. And as much as it is our prayer that all who hear will in fact choose Jesus, moreover, as the song we just sang, and as Luke and all of Scripture tells us, before we can make that choice, we must first grasp Jesus chose us first. Jesus, in his infinite love and grace, came to earth, put on our flesh, and suffered and died in our place. We would never have the opportunity to choose Jesus if Jesus had not first come to vanquish the darkness of our own sin and grant us the choice to accept his radiant promise of eternal life. And again, I also love these words we just sang. What love, my God, so gracious and extreme, was strong enough to come and fight for me, to go through hell and down into the grave and raise me up to see you face to face. It's beautiful. It's amazing. Let's now listen to a few friends who will help describe for us from Luke's account just how gracious and extreme Jesus' love really is.
One day Jesus left the crowds to pray alone. Only his disciples were with him, and he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" "Well," they replied, "some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say you are one of the other ancient prophets risen from the dead." Then he asked them, "But who do you say I am?" Peter replied, "You are the Messiah sent from God." Jesus warned his disciples not to tell anyone who he is. "The Son of Man must suffer many terrible things," he said. "He will be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. He will be killed, but on the third day, he will be raised from the dead." Then he said to the crowd, "If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross daily and follow me." While everyone was marveling at everything he was doing, Jesus said to his disciples, "Listen to me and remember what I say. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of his enemies." But they didn't know what he meant. Its significance was hidden from them, so they couldn't understand it, and they were afraid to ask him about it. Taking the 12 disciples aside, Jesus said, "Listen, we're going up to Jerusalem, where all the predictions of the prophets concerning the Son of Man will come true. He will be handed over to the Romans, and he will be mocked, treated shamefully, and spit upon. They will flog him with a whip and kill him, but on the third day he will rise again." But they didn't understand any of this. The significance of his words was hidden from them, and they failed to grasp what he was talking about.
The festival of unleavened bread, which is also called Passover, was approaching. The leading priests and teachers of religious law were plotting how to kill Jesus, but they were afraid of the people's reaction. Then Satan entered into Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12 disciples, and he went to the leading priests and captain of the temple guard to discuss the best way to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted, and they promised to give him money. So he agreed and began looking for an opportunity to betray Jesus so they could arrest him when the crowds weren't around.
When the time came, Jesus and the apostles sat down together at the table. Jesus said, "I have been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you now that I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. Then he said, "Take this and share it among yourselves, for I will not drink wine again until the kingdom of God has come." He took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it into pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took another cup of wine and said, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you."
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice. Table of the King. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King. Thank you. every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drained death's cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of abundance of grace around the table of
Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose from prayer and went to the back to the disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray so you'll not fall into temptation."
But even as Jesus said this, a crowd approached, led by Judas, one of the 12 disciples. Judas walked over to Jesus to greet him with a kiss. But Jesus said, "Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss?" When the other disciples saw what was about to happen, they exclaimed, "Lord, should we fight?" "We brought the swords." And one of them struck at the high priest's slave, slashing off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched the man's ear and healed him. Then Jesus spoke to the leading priests, the captains of the temple guard, and the elders who had come for him. "Am I some dangerous revolutionary," he asked, "that you come with swords and clubs to arrest me? Why didn't you arrest me in the temple? I was there every day. But this is your moment, the time when the power of darkness reigns."
I want you to imagine with me for a moment. Imagine what it would be like to be in a situation where you are gathered together with your oldest and dearest friends, when all of a sudden the door splinters, and a moment later it's kicked right off its hinges and comes down with a crash, and in storms a band of armed military personnel, one of them screaming out, "Where is he?" You look around, you're confused, you're scared, your head's in a complete daze, and out of the mouth of one of your closest friends you hear words. Words you never in a million years expected to hear coming from his mouth. "He's right there! This one, Take him. He's the one you're looking for. He points towards your best friend. And this is as backstabbing as it gets. One close friend betraying another before your very eyes. Now, these jackbooted thugs grab your friend. They toss him to the ground right in front of you. They put him in shackles and they drag him away like a helpless animal. So what do you do? Do you helplessly try to rescue your friend by randomly attacking these brutes like one of the disciples did? Or would you go into retreat, hoping no one would learn that you were once associated with this friend now turned convict? See, it's hard for us to imagine such a scenario. A terrifying moment like this would be forever cemented in our memories. So every Good Friday, we retell this dreadful experience, not too unlike the one just imagined, where not just a random friend, but the friend, an individual who held the hopes and dreams and salvation of an entire nation, was betrayed by his own disciple in front of his closest companions, accomplished with the most poisonous and infamous kiss ever given. In the history of our planet, has there ever been a darker, more disorienting hour? Jesus himself claimed nothing less than this. When being dragged away, he uttered, "This is your hour when darkness reigns." The hour when darkness reigned. Are there more dreadful words imaginable than these? Yet, as terrifying as these words are, these haunting words of Jesus also carry a notion of hope. See, for an hour is only a measurement of time. And all measurements and all time allotments have a beginning and an end. And a measurement of darkness can only end with an invasion of light. Let's listen a little more to how Luke describes this period of darkness for our Lord.
The guards in charge of Jesus began mocking and beating him. They blindfolded him and said, "Prophesy to us. Who hit you at that time?" And they hurled all sorts of terrible insults at him. At daybreak, all the elders of the people assembled, including the leading priests and the teachers of the religious law. Jesus was led before this high council, and they said, "Tell us, are you the Messiah?" But he replied, "If I tell you, you won't believe me. And if I ask you a question, you won't answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated in the place of power at God's right hand." They all shouted, "So are you claiming to be the Son of God?" And he replied, "You say that I am. Why do we need other witnesses?" They said, "We ourselves heard him say it." Then the entire council took Jesus to Pilate, the Roman governor. They began to state their case. "This man has been leading our people astray by telling them not to pay their taxes to the Roman government and by claiming he is the Messiah, a king." So Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus replied, "You have said it." Pilate turned to the leading priests and to the crowd and said, "I find nothing wrong with this man." They became insistent.
Then Pilate called together the leading priests and other religious leaders, along with the people, and he announced his verdict. "You brought this man to me, accusing him of leading a revolt. I have examined him thoroughly on this point in your presence and find him innocent. Herod came to the same conclusion and sent him back to us. Nothing this man has done calls for the death penalty, so I will have him flogged, and then I will release him." Then a mighty roar rose from the crowd, and with one voice they shouted, "Kill him and release Barabbas to us." Barabbas was in prison for taking part in an insurrection in Jerusalem against the government and for the murder. Pilate argued with them because he wanted to release Jesus, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." For the third time he demanded, "Why? What crime has he committed? I have found no reason to sentence him to death, so I will have him flogged, and then I will release him." But the mob shouted louder and louder, demanding that Jesus be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate sentenced Jesus to die as they demanded. As they had requested, he released Barabbas, the man in prison for insurrection and murder, but he turned Jesus over to them to do as they wished.
Well, I've heard it said that a man would climb a mountain just to be with the one he loves. How many times has he broken that promise? It has never been done. Well, I never climbed the highest mountain, but I walked the hill of Calvary just to be with you. I would do anything. There's no price I would not pay. No, and just to be with you, I would give everything, and I would give my to be with you, I would do anything. There's no price I would not pay. No, and just to be with you, I would give everything, and I would give my life away. Yeah, yeah. That I give you, and I promise that I will do it all again. And just to be with you, I've done everything. There's no price I did not pay.
As they led Jesus away, a man named Simon, who was from Cyrene, happened to be coming in from the countryside. The soldiers seized him and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd trailed behind, including many grief-stricken women. But Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, don't weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are coming when they will say, 'Fortunate indeed are the women who are childless, who never bore babies, who never nursed.' People will beg the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and plead with the hills, 'Bury us.' For if these things are done when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with him.
When they came to the place called the Skull, they nailed him to the cross. And the criminals were also crucified, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." And the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. The crowd watched, and the leaders scoffed. "He saves others. Let him save himself if he's really God, Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers mocked him too by offering him a drink of sour wine. They called out to him, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." A sign was fastened above him with these words, "This is the King of the Jews." By this time, it was about noon, and the darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. The light from the sun was gone, and suddenly the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn down the middle. Then Jesus shouted, "Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands." And with those words, he breathed his last. When the Roman officer overseeing the execution saw what had happened, he worshipped God and said, "Surely this man is innocent." And when all the crowd that came to see the crucifixion saw what had happened, they went home in deep sorrow. But Jesus' friends, including the woman who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance watching.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and poor contempt on all my pride. love demands my soul. My life, my all.
I never like giving away the ending of a story. However, I think we all know, despite how bad things looked on this day of history, we look back now and declare this dark day a good day. On Sunday, we will come together again and celebrate the miraculous way the darkness of this Friday was extinguished with the glorious rising at dawn. And simply put, we could say, yes, darkness reigned on Crucifixion Friday, but light reigned on Resurrection Sunday. And every day that follows. However, there's more to it than this. See, Good Friday sets before us a choice, a challenge we don't have the luxury to ignore. And as we consider our theme of choosing Jesus, we each must make the conscious choice of whether or not we will choose Jesus for our own lives. Will we choose the beautiful gift of eternal life and the freeing forgiveness from our own darkness that Jesus offers? Will we allow Jesus' blazing light to reign in us? Or will we reject that light and cling to the darkness of our own sin? To help us think through this choice, I want us to briefly consider one of the most tragic people we read about in the Good Friday account. None other than Pontius Pilate. See, who could have convinced Pilate that he was about to pass judgment on the Son of God? He almost opted to acquit Jesus. Almost. He had the power. He had the choice. The option to free God's Son was his. And he almost did it. But Pilate's pride got the best of him. Pilate's fear of being accused of being disloyal to Caesar made him give in to the mob's demands. Pilate's hunger for power and prestige won out over justice. Pilate stood eye to eye with Jesus. 5 times he postponed the decision, hoping to appease the obsessed crowd with lashings. Yet Jesus kept getting sent back to him. 3 times he stood face to face with the Messiah. Pilate could have listened to his wife. She pleaded with him, "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him," from Matthew 27. Although Pilate was troubled as well, he refused to listen to her. And Pilate could have listened to his conscience. He obviously could see through the facade. In fact, he washed his hands of it all. He knew these phony high priests were only hosting a show trial, a theatrical spectacle and nothing more. But he ignored his conscience too. Pilate's greatest weakness was his avoidance. You can't clean your hands from making a choice and think that washes with Jesus. You are either with Jesus or against him. You either choose Jesus' light or you tragically remain in your own dungeon of darkness. And like Pilate, we also have to respond one way or the other. We must follow Jesus or walk away from him. A choice is before each of us. What do we decide with Christ's cross? One thing we can't do is walk away in indecision. No fence sitting's permitted, the cross doesn't allow it, and God doesn't permit it. What's your choice? Who will you let reign? The forgiving light that is Jesus, or the damning darkness of your sin? The choice is yours. Would you please pray and consider this most important of all choices as you hear this next song?
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
We've come to the end of our service, but before we finish this morning, let me remind you of two important things. First, we hope to see you all, either in person or online, for our Easter Sunday services. We will be having 4 in-person services in Fenlon and 3 in Bob Cajun. You'll want to take note of the times of these and get signed up for these. You can find that on our website. And sadly, because we don't have space to accommodate everyone, think about who you can send the link of our online Easter service to. We want as many people as possible to celebrate and experience the resurrection triumph of our Lord Jesus. Secondly, let me remind you of this. History records for us that Pilate was a ruthless governor. During his command, countless victims were crushed and killed under his authority. Yet, when you read the accounts of his encounter with Jesus, there was something about this single, solitary Jew who got this tyrant's attention. This Jew made Pilate pause, made Pilate think, and stirred in Pilate to ask, "What is truth?" Jesus did not have to give Pilate an answer, because Pilate already knew he was looking directly into the eyes of the answer to his question. Truth, purpose, and hope are found only in Jesus. This Jew from Nazareth, Pilate knew he couldn't convict, but Pilate did not have the courage to pronounce him not guilty. So today, Pilate is remembered in the history books, not as a powerful, rigid leader, but as a wavering, lost, and sympathetic soul who was not strong enough in his convictions to accept Jesus, and too weak to outright reject him. Our prayer this Easter weekend is this. If there are any of you who find yourselves on the fence, who are still wrestling with what to do about choosing Jesus, choosing to follow Jesus, we pray today you will no longer waver, that you will no longer wash your hands of making that decision. Let this day be the day that you say, "The hour of the darkness of my sin has come to an end. Today I choose Jesus. Today I choose to embrace his light, his love, his forgiveness, which he paid for me on Calvary's cross."
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. And I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange someday for a crown. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a
Thank you.